Ujian promosi Doktor Pendidikan Pasca Sarjana Universitas Negeri Semarang, Kamis 18 Februari 2021, atas nama Saudari DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD, dimulai. Sekretaris penguji melaporkan kepada Ketua Penguji bahwa ujian promosi Doktor Pendidikan siap dimulai.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Pak Rektor yang amat cendekia, Bapak Ibu penguji yang sangat terpelajar, para tamu undangan yang kami hormati, dengan mengucap syukur Alhamdulillah, pada hari ini Kamis 18 Februari 2021, Program Studi Ilmu Pendidikan Bahasa Pasca Sarjana Universitas Negeri Semarang mengajukan Saudari DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD sebagai promovenda untuk dapat diujikan disertasinya yang berjudul Systemic Functional Multimodal Discourse Analysis of the Lecturers Utterance and Gesture used in Teaching, Reading, and Writing. Saya laporkan kepada Bapak Rektor dan para penguji bahwa promovenda telah menyelesaikan semua perkuliahan serta telah menjalani beberapa tahapan pengujian disertasi sebelumnya di Pasca Sarjana UNES dan kesemuanya dinyatakan lulus, serta telah memenuhi syarat untuk ujian disertasi tahap 2 ini. Oleh karena itu, saya mohon Bapak Rektor selaku Ketua Penguji berkenan untuk membuka dan sekaligus memimpin ujian disertasi secara resmi. Akhirul kalam, wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Para promovenda, sekarang ini Pak Rektor sedang ada acara dan beliau menugasi saya untuk membuka dan memimpin ujian ini. Mungkin nanti di tengah-tengah ujian beliau akan bergabung masuk. Apakah saudari bersedia?
Bersedia, Prof.
Baik, sebelum ujian saya buka, saya bertanya dulu pada saudari, apakah saudari dalam keadaan sehat jasmani rohani?
Alhamdulillah saya sehat dari ini, Pak.
Baik. Apakah karya yang nanti sudah dipertahankan adalah karya asli saudari sendiri?
Ya.
Silakan baca surat pernyataan keaslian serta tanda tangani di atas meterai.
Pernyataan keaslian. Dengan ini saya, nama Sri Mulatsih, NIM 02016130009, program studi Ilmu Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris S3, menyatakan bahwa yang tertulis dalam disertasi saya yang berjudul A Systemic Functional Multimodal Discourse Analysis of Utterances and Gestures Used by the Lecturers in Teaching, Reading, and Writing ini benar-benar karya sendiri. Bukan jiplakan dari karya orang lain atau pengutipan dengan cara-cara yang tidak sesuai dengan etika keilmuan yang berlaku, baik sebagian atau seluruhnya. Pendapat atau temuan orang lain yang terdapat dalam disertasi ini dikutip atau dirujuk berdasarkan kode etik ilmiah. Atas pernyataan ini, saya secara pribadi siap menanggung resiko dan sanksi hukum yang dijatuhkan apabila ditemukan adanya pelanggaran terhadap etika keilmuan dalam karya ini. Semarang, 18 Februari 2021, yang menyatakan Sri Mulatsih. Sudah saya tanda tangani, Prof, untuk sebuah pernyataan saya.
Baik, sudah cukup.
Yeah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Ujian promosi doktor pendidikan saudari DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD secara resmi saya nyatakan dibuka. Selanjutnya saya perkenalkan tim penguji saudari. Ketua Profesor Dr. Fathur Rahman M.Hum, Sekretaris Profesor Dr. Agus Nuryadin M.Hum, anggota 1 Profesor Dr. Suwandi M.Pd sebagai penguji 1, 2 Prof. 2 Sri Muli Fitriati S.Pd. M.Pd. Ph.D. sebagai penguji 2, 3 Profesor Dr. Januarius Mujianto M.Hum sebagai penguji 3.
Selamat pagi.
Pagi ya. 4 Profesor Dr. Isi Yuliasri M.Pd. sebagai penguji 4. 5 Profesor Dr. Warsono M.A. sebagai penguji 5. 6 Profesor Mursid Saleh PhD sebagai penguji 6. Selanjutnya Saudari Promo Penda dipersilakan untuk berdoa terlebih dahulu. Silakan paparkan karya saudari, waktu maksimal 15 menit.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. The honorable the board of examiners, in this nice occasion, please allow me to present my dissertation entitled A Systemic Functional Multimodal Discourse Analysis, SFMDA of Utterances and Gestures Used by the Lecturers in Teaching, Reading, and Writing. Background of my study, all teaching and learning in the classroom should involve a range of modes, including speech, writing, gestures, gaze, body posture, movement, and so on. In other words, teaching and learning in the classroom are multimodal. Different modes available in the classroom have different information carried by those modes. Two modes, in this case lectures, utterances, and gestures, are two types of modes that are very important in supporting the teaching and learning processes. Why? Because gestures, I think, the utterances and gestures are given to give some information, and also gestures are used to support the teaching and learning process. That's why here in my dissertation, I want to analyze the lectures, utterances, and gestures used by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing by using the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis. There are several previous studies that I put in my dissertation, but here I only put 4 previous studies. Those are by Walls in 2012 about SFMDA on novel pictures, books, and internet site. 2 Ajayi in 2012 about SFMDA on textbooks, and then Halloran, SFMDA on advertisement, and then Lim 2011, SFMDA on 2 classes of journal paper in junior college in Singapore. The differences between those previous studies is, and my study is that my study use the utterances and gestures used in 2 different classes, different skill. Those are reading and writing, reading and writing. Yeah, one is the receptive, and the second one is the productive one. The scope of my study. Yeah, this study is limited on the analysis of modes used by the lecturers in the teaching of reading and writing. The modes discussed here are utterances used and gestures performed during the teaching and learning process in the classroom. Systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis is used as a framework of the study. The objective of the study. The main objective of the study is to portray the realization of additional interpersonal and textual meanings in the lecturer's utterances and gesture in teaching reading and writing. This main objective is broken down into 9 objectives. They are, number 1, to figure out the processes, participants, and circumstances used in the lecturer's utterances in teaching reading and writing. Number 2, to figure out the realization of processes, participants, and circumstances used in the lecturer's utterances in wording. Number 3, to figure out the type of mood used by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing. Number 4, to figure out the appraisals given by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing. Number 5, to figure out the dominant theme used by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing. Number 6, to describe the type of gestures performed by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing. Number 7, to figure out the additional meanings of lecturers' gestures in teaching, reading, and writing. Number 10, to figure out the interpersonal meanings of lecturers' gestures in teaching, reading, and writing. And the last one is to figure out the textual meanings of lecturers' gestures in teaching, reading, and writing. The theory I use in my study are a systemic functional linguistic, systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis, additional meaning, interpersonal meaning, textual meaning, teaching reading, teaching writing, utterances, and gestures. Research method. This study is qualitative research of a classroom discourse that is intended to identify the additional meaning, interpersonal meaning, and textual meaning of the lecturer's utterances and gestures performed in teaching, reading, and writing. To discuss the additional interpersonal and textual meaning of the lecturer's utterances used in teaching and writing, the framework proposed by Halliday, 1994, and Martin and Rose, 2005, were applied. To answer the research question about the additional, the interpersonal, and textual meaning of the lecturer's gesture in teaching, reading, and writing, the framework proposed by Halloran and Lim about the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis were applied. Now, the finding. In terms of additional meaning, the processes used mostly in utterances of the lecturer's teaching, reading, writing is relational with carrier and attribute as the participant. The dominancy of relational process in reading and writing class is caused by the condition that the teaching processes that explain several terms that have relation with the material being discussed in the classroom. The realization of processes in wording is mostly in form of non-phrasal verb in present tense. The realization of participant is mostly in non-consisting, and the circumstances are mostly in micro ones. In terms of interpersonal meaning, the mood type mostly used in both lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing is declarative. Declarative mood is dominant in both reading and writing classes because teaching is the process of giving information to students about the materials. Interrogative mood are also used in both classes, I think, to ask the question, to ask the student about the understanding about the materials. The appraisal used by the lecturers consists of attitude, graduation, and engagement. Both lecturers in reading and writing classes use more positive attitude than the negative one. Why? Or more positive, because I think positive attitude will motivate students in the classroom. In graduation, in both reading and writing classes, the lecturers use more focus than force. It means that the appraisal produced by both lecturers are used to summon the utterances, not to threat, you know, the students. In engagement, both lecturers use more monogloss than heterogloss. It means that the sources of the appraisal used by both lecturers are from the lecturers themselves, not from others. In textual meaning, the themes mostly used in the utterances of both lecturers in reading and writing are topical and marked because there are several topics being discussed as the subjects of the clause. And then number 6, there are 2 types of gestures performed by the lecturers in reading and writing classes. They are communicative and performative gesture. The gesture performed by the lecturers in reading the teaching and learning processes. Actually, there are also some performative gestures, meaning that the gestures that don't have meaning and don't support the teaching learning. Well, I'll continue my presentations. Yeah, sorry for the connections. Well, I think for number six, there are two type of gestures performed by the lecturers in reading and writing classes. They are communicative and performative gestures. Communicative gestures are those that have meaning and support the teaching and learning process, while performative gestures, I think, are those that don't have meaning. The gestures performed by the lecturer in reading and writing are mostly communicative ones. This means that those gestures have meaning and support the teaching and learning process. In terms of additional meanings, the process of the gesture performed by the lecturers in both reading and writing classes are materials. It means that in the teaching and learning processes, both lecturers perform some action to support the teaching and to help the student understand the material. For number eight, in interpersonal meanings, both lecturers in reading and writing classes mostly use positive gestures. Positive gestures are mostly used to create good atmosphere in the classroom. Both lecturers don't use negative gesture that make the student less motivated. In textual meaning, the lecturer's gestures are realized in two ways. They are pointing directionality and pointing specificity. Pointing specificity is used more than pointing directionality because the lecturers mostly perform specificity pointing to the student. It can be said that pointing specificity, meaning that the lecturers here mostly directed the gesture for the students. And directionality pointing is also performed, but not many actually. This is directed to the whiteboard or sometimes to the screen. Okay, for the implications, the use of several modes in the classroom is important since every mode used by the lecturers in the classroom communicate meanings. Therefore, lecturers should use more than one mode through the teaching and learning processes and also to help the student understand the materials being discussed in the classroom. The study is expected to give the contribution to the next research about systemic functional linguistic and systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis in a classroom discourse. Okay, I think that's all for my presentation. Thank you very much.
Baik, selanjutnya di pertama Profesor Dr. Suwandi MBD, dipersilakan Prof, waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Terima kasih Bapak Direktur yang sangat cendekia, yang sangat saya hormati. Terima kasih atas kesempatan yang diberikan kepada saya untuk menyampaikan pertanyaan dan sanggahan pada ujian terbuka atas nama Sri Mulatse. Congratulations Bu Mulatse for having completed the draft of your dissertation, and I hope today you will be able to defend the result of your study and will be able to answer all the questions presented by the examiners.
Yeah, thank you.
My questions will be something dealing with the title of your dissertation, the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis of utterances and gestures used by lecturers in teaching reading and writing. The question is, what benefit do you gain from analyzing the gestures and utterances used by the lecturers in teaching reading and writing? And what is the contribution to the EFL teaching?
OK, Okay, thank you, Prof, for the question. Well, the benefit of analyzing systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis to the utterances and gestures performed by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing is that this kind of analysis will be the contribution for the lecturers, because you know that in the teaching learning process, the lecturers should not only use one mode, but they should use more than one mode. Like in this case, I choose utterances and gestures, because every utterance and every gesture performed by the lecturer here have meaning. And of course, here support the teaching and learning process. For example, in the utterances, utterances given by the lecturer will be used to give some information or explaining something to the student. And then also the gestures, I think gestures here are used to give a kind of support, you know, by the lecturers to explain something. But my example is that when the lecturer only explain by sitting down on the chair without doing any gesture, but it will make the class like feel bored or something. But if the lecturers, while they are teaching in the classroom, they use gesture. And this gesture here, of course, will support the teaching and learning process. And of course, it is kind of analysis here, because the meaning of gesture and utterances here are very important here. So it will become the contribution to the teaching and English language teaching here, Prof. Thank you.
Okay. And do you have any criteria for considering that certain mood should be used in teaching, reading, and writing?
Excuse me, certain criteria?
Yeah, do you have any criteria for considering that certain mood should be used in teaching, reading, and writing? Maybe the total number of the mood used in teaching, reading, or writing.
Mood or mode, sir?
What?
Mood or mode?
Is there a difference? Okay, so can you also explain the difference between mode and mood?
Okay, right. First, I want to explain the differences between mood and mode. Mode, I think, is anything that become the source of meaning. For example, in the classroom, there are several modes. The mode can be utterances here, can be the written language, can be the gesture, can be the movement in the classroom. But the mode here is the pattern of exchanging information in the classroom. For example, when a teacher mostly use the teaching is can be declarative, can be interrogative, or can be imperative. Declarative is used to give some information to the student, and then interrogative is used to ask some question or demand something, and then imperative is used to order or command something. That's why there's different between mode and mood, sir.
Okay. Yeah, that is why I asked you about the criteria for considering that certain mood or modes should be used in teaching, reading, and writing. In research question number 3, you are asking about types of mood.
Oh yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, type of mood. Yeah.
Types of mood. Yeah. So, from each type of mood, you also have the data here. That's on page 20.
Yes. Of
your summary. Yeah. There's a summary. The types of. Excuse me. Is that right? The types of mood?
Yes. Can I explain the type of mood?
Yeah.
Well, the type of mood mostly used by the lecturers in teaching, reading, and writing both are declarative. Most dominantly is declarative, because in the process of teaching and learning, the lecturer mostly give some information or explain something about the material being discussed. It is why here declarative mood is dominant. Interrogative mode is also used here to check the understanding of the student, for example, in reading, do you understand the material, what's the meaning of this, and so on. And imperative is also used in the classroom, but it is not dominantly used. And it is used to order or ask students to do something, like, for example, write a recount, or tomorrow you have to bring something. Yeah. So it is imperative. That's why three of them are used in the classroom.
Declarative, interrogative, and imperative.
Yes.
And if you differentiate here between the teaching of reading and writing, yeah, in which declarative is used more in writing rather than in reading. Why?
Declarative is used more in writing, in reading, in writing, because declarative is used more in writing because in writing, I think there are several instruction that must be given by the lecturers to make the student understand how to write something. Yeah, that's why here declarative is mostly used in writing. And I think in reading is also important to give some information to the student about certain term or certain material given in the classroom.
Okay. Do you find the gap between the ideal one of using utterances and gestures in teaching reading and writing and the reality in the field?
The gap here?
Yeah.
Okay. In reality, the student not an, in reality, I think all the lecturer usually use the utterances in the classroom, but not all lecturers here use the gestures in the classroom. I think there are some lecturers also just sit on the chair without giving any gestures. But actually, the ideal one, I think they should use gestures in the classroom to support the teaching and learning process.
In your recent study, you also mentioned that lecturers did not, what they said, did not use gestures of movement. Is it possible that teaching reading or writing without gestures or movement? I think it is too extreme to say this. Yeah. That they did not use other modes such as gestures or movement. Teachers tend to sit down silently on the chair. What do you think?
That's about the problems that I also found when I was studying in S1, that most of my lecturers, I think, just sitting down without giving gesture or movement in the classroom. That's why here I try to analyze the use of gestures in the classroom, the use of the meaning of gesture in the classroom. And in this study, I only limit the mode on the two, the utterances and gesture, not the movement, sir. Yeah, I only choose two type of mode here.
In short, gestures and utterances are very important in the teaching of reading and writing. They play role, right?
Yes, I think so.
What is new here in your study?
My new, I think, about the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis. Usually, the analysis only one mode, but in this case, I analyze two types of mode. Utterances and gesture are two types of mode. So that's why it is my novelty of my study.
Okay, thank you so much for answering the questions. Time is over. So, terima kasih Bapak Direktur. Saya kembalikan waktunya kepada Bapak.
Baik, terima kasih Prof. Mandi. Penguji berikutnya, Ibu Sri Wuli Fitriani, SPD, MPD, PhD. Dipersilakan Bu Wuli waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Baik, terima kasih Bapak Direktur yang sangat saya hormati. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ibu Mulatse. How are you, Ibu?
Fine.
Pagi. Yeah. Alhamdulillah. Congratulations, Bu Aceh. you should be very happy today because today is the promotion day of you to be a doctor in the English language education. Selamat Ibu ya. Okay. I need to give you some questions, yeah, because I need you to make some clarifications what you have written in your dissertation, Bu Asih. Okay. Let's start from identification of the problem. Yeah. On page 6, identification of the problem on page 6, the last sentence, please. Do you have a copy of your dissertation with you?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Can you please read aloud the last sentence of this section, identification of the problem?
Yeah. That's why this study investigated the meanings of lecturers' utterances and gesture in teaching the class of reading and writing in order that the use of several modes is expected to improve the teaching and learning process in the classroom.
Mm-mm. Okay, thank you. My question is whether your thesis also aims to improving the quality of the teaching learning process?
No.
Okay, no. So go on, you first.
My aim of my study find the improvement, no, but because if it is an improvement, mm-hmm. of course I must do excellent research, but it is not improvement,
yes.
it is a mm-hmm. analysis of discourse analysis, systemic mm-hmm. functional multimodal discourse analysis, so there is no mm-hmm. kind of excellent research or treatment in
action.
The
study. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree with you. I absolutely agree with you. What I mean is that if you state like this, it's kind of misleading for your readers, because your readers' expectation that you do something in your research, like doing a treatment. Perhaps you just need to restructure the sentence by giving assumption based on your preliminary research that the classroom interactions which are influenced by different types of modes will influence the teaching learning process. Yeah, so it's a matter of how you restructure the sentence so that your readers will not get any sense that you are doing something, that you did a research, you did treatment in the classes that you investigated.
It's only my expectation, okay. Bully. My expectation in the use of gesture in the classroom will improve the teaching and learning process.
Yeah, I understand. My suggestion is restructure the sentences.
Yes.
Mm-mm, okay. Next, statement of the problem, Ibu. Statement of the problems. Well, did you also, in your research, did you also attempt to make any relationship? Did you try to make an analysis of the relationship between utterances and gestures by using two framework?
To the connection between utterances and gestures.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
No, in this case, I just want to analyze the utterances themselves from the interpersonal meaning, additional meaning, and textual meaning. And the second one is the analysis of gestures. You know?
Yeah, I understand about that.
Additional and textual meaning. Mm-hmm. And also type of.
And gestures. You use the framework of CREST, yeah? For the multimodal discourse analysis, right? Yeah. So I wonder whether you also make any attempt to make to analyze the relationship between utterances and gesture, but you didn't. So can you please acknowledge that in your scope of the study, please? Because when we see the title, if you use utterances and gesture, it seems like there should be any connection, any relationship between utterances and gesture, but you didn't do that. That's fine. Yeah, I'd like you acknowledge that in the scope of your study.
Yes. Yeah, in the scope of my study, I mentioned there are two modes analyzed here. One is utterances, and second one is gestures.
Mm-mm. You know. Mm-mm. Okay, but you didn't but you didn't go further by investigating the relationship, did you?
No.
Okay, that's fine. That's all right. Yeah, I'm not asking you to do further research. No, perhaps that's for recommendation for further research. Yeah, what I say?
Yes.
Okay, good. Now the research objective. Well, I think we have discussed in the previous meeting. dissertation should be go deeper rather than to figure out, because according to the dictionary, figure out means discover or identifying. Why don't you use the phrase to explain?
Yeah, actually it's only the choice of words really. to describe and explain, but I'm confused which word that is suitable for this, figure out or to describe. That's why to make it different, I try sometimes to figure out, sometimes to describe, sometimes to to explain sometimes, maybe. I will add.
Well, actually, yeah. You should have checked in the dictionary that all the words that you mentioned have different sense of meaning. Yeah. Explain, of course, go beyond description. Explaining means that you try to give interpretations about the data.
Yes.
I have checked in the dictionary that figure out means identifying. You just identify, yeah, what mood types used by the teachers, what types of gesture used by the teachers. That's describing. But explaining, it's necessary for dissertation project because you have to give deeper insights to your readers. So again, my suggestions for this phrase, to explain, not figure out, if you accept my suggestions.
Yes,
but you have to think about it, yeah?
Yeah, in my study, I also not only describe, but also explain here.
Yes. This thick dissertation show us that this is beyond description. This is very good because you're also explaining. Yeah. It's a matter of the word that you use in the section statement of the objective of the research. But you did explanation. Yes, I agree with you, Bu Ase.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's a matter of the choice of words of figure out.
Yes.
Well, Bu Ase, in definition of keyword, you explain that gesture also include facial expression, right? On page 14, you stated that gesture includes face, facial expression. However, in which part of your findings and discussion section that you explain about facial expression? If I'm not mistaken, you mentioned two types of gesture, right? Pointing specificity and pointing directionality. So in which part of your findings you talk about facial expression of the lecturers?
No. Because facial, it's difficult for me to find the theory of facial expression in gesture, Bully. That's why I agree the body movement given by the lectures.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. I just need you to clarify. If you do not include facial expressions in your investigation, so please delete face, the word face in the definition of keyword, page 14.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, can you explain, Bu Mulatsi, the methodological contributions of your research on ELT in Indonesia? Methodological, because this is very interesting. You used systemic functional linguistics multimodal discourse analysis, and I expect that you found something new related to the methodology. Please explain about that.
Well, why I propose systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis here, and for the ELT, I think it is very useful because in teaching and learning processes, as I told before, that the lecturers should not only use mode in the classroom, but they should use more than that. because I think some both here contribute meaning because they are communicative one and of course communicative meaning. That's why it is very useful really for the ELT.
Okay. Yeah, that's great. Please add one novelty in relation to the methodology. Yes. Yeah, the novelty of your research in relation to methodology.
Waktu habis.
That's last question. Yeah, Bapak. Oke, congratulations again Bu Asih. Saya kembalikan waktu ke Bapak Direktur. Matur nuwun Bapak Direktur. Ya, yeah, you're welcome.
Penguji berikutnya Profesor Dr. Janura Januarius Mujianto MHUM. Dipersilakan Prof. Yan waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Ya, terima kasih Prof. Agus Nuryatin yang sangat cendekia. Bu Sri Mulatsih, yeah. First of all, I should like to congratulate you on completing your draft. So you are allowed to sit down here for your promotion. Yeah.
Thank you.
In very short time, the director will put PhD or doctor, yeah, in front of or at the end by the end of your names, yeah. And PhD means philosophy doctor, yeah, philosophy doctor. What does it mean? It means that you should know a bit, even a bit, about the principles of philosophy, yeah. In philosophy, there are three aspects that you should know. That is ontology, epistemology, and axiology. Yeah. Ontology is about the existence of knowledge. Epistemology is the process of gaining knowledge. And axiology is talking about the value of knowledge. Right? Okay. And then now, your dissertation, yeah. You are only asking questions using what is, what are, and so on. It means that you are only talking about ontology, that is the existence of knowledge, yeah. Now the question is, where did you put the process of gaining knowledge, yeah? The process of gaining knowledge, that is methodology. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Paul. Thank you. Well, my research question mostly use what?
All
use what? But here, in the answer or in the finding, I think I not only describe about something, but I also give the reason why here actually.
Why? Yeah. What about how? What about the process of gaining knowledge?
If I answer the question, if give the question how, I think it is not suitable for this because one, two.
Are you sure or not sure? Are you sure or not sure? If you are talking about the process of gaining knowledge, that the question is with how, right? If you are talking about the process of the existence. You are talking about the process. You are talking about the existence of knowledge. Then you are using what? Yeah. If you are talking about the value of knowledge, then you are talking. You are asking questions with why? Yeah. That is the basic. Yeah. The basic. The preliminary. Yeah. Knowledge of philosophy. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Think about it. Yeah. Read more about philosophy because your clerk will be PhD. Right. Philosophy doctor. And, yes. Okay, next point is that I found in your references that you've got 57 pages, yeah, 57 pages of references, of list of references. If one page contains 10 items of references, then it means that here you have 570 references. 570 references. Okay, right. And then you take a look at, if you take a look at a review of previous studies, yeah, the review of previous studies, You only mentioned six. You only mentioned six writers. Ya, yang 564 kemana? Okay, right. Okay, you need to ask yourself, yeah, questions also, yeah, because according to the rule, according to the regulations by the rector of UNES, then you just need around 100 research articles. But then, out of the 100 research articles, then you've got to review them all. Review them all, not just six, ya, yeah. Oke, okay. Ya, yeah. Itu saya sampaikan juga, ya, yeah. Oke. Okay. There are only six, ya, yeah. There are only six articles that you review in chapter 2, right? Yeah.
But I okay. Use it all in a
there
in
are only six.
Presentation. In the part of
presentation. Yeah, yeah, but the problem is that the title is review of previous studies, yeah. The title is review of previous studies. You should have to review, yeah. Okay, but you only mentioned six out of 570, yeah. Okay, yeah. Take a look at it again, and then now I'm not talking about the consistency of your thesis, yeah. You have nine, yeah. You have nine research questions, right?
Yes.
Am I right? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
And then you have nine objectives. Am I right? Nine objectives.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And you only have six contributions. Okay. Six contributions. Okay. Or significance. Yeah.
Can I explain, Prof?
Oh, no, it's not necessary. Yeah. This is, yeah. Okay. Then you have only seven findings. Yeah. Seven findings. Okay. Now explain. Nine, six, seven, right? Okay, come on, you if you want to explain it.
Yes, okay. I have six research question, nine research question, nine objective, and only six significant. Why? Because the question number one and number two, this belong to additional meaning, and I put it in one number. For significant number one, it consists of two research questions, number one and number two, because both of them belongs to additional meaning. And also in the second number about the interpersonal meaning, there are mood and appraisal here. Also, I combine into one significant, because it's belong to interpersonal meaning. That's why here from nine here into six significance, because if I put it in different number it will be little word outward. I think that's why.
Okay,
I
okay. And then why did you only have seven findings?
I have nine.
Well, you have nine discussions. Yeah,
I have
okay
nine.
Seven findings and nine discussions. No, in your thesis, I only have 7 points, yeah, seven items of findings, yeah, seven items. Okay, yeah, you check it again, yeah, there are only seven, yeah. And why do I have to talk about the nine questions, nine objectives, nine significance, nine findings, nine discussions, and nine conclusions? Just because that is the benang merah, that is the red string of karya ilmiah, yeah, scientific study, yeah, red string, and research questions, objectives, and so on are actually the simples, the noodles of the string, yeah, right. Jadi begitu konsistensinya, yeah. Okay, yeah, okay, yeah. So if you have to talk about six significance now. Now, by the way, significance, is it countable or uncountable? Now.
Countable.
Did you check it in your dictionary or not? Yeah. Okay. Okay, you check it in your dictionary, right? Okay. Okay, don't be so sure if you are not sure, right? Okay, yeah, all right. And then next point is about grammarly, yeah, grammar, your grammatical correctness, yeah, grammatical correctness. I checked your grammar in application.grammarly.com, and your score is less than adequate. Yeah. Okay. Maybe because you did not check your grammar in the application.grammarly.com. So again, if you are not so sure about the correctness of your grammar, then check it in grammarly.com. Okay. Yeah. Because again, your grammar score, according to Google, Google.com, is less than adequate, only around 57, right? 56, right? Yeah, 56 or 57, less, yeah, jauh di bawah yang diperlukan, yeah. Okay, and then, check again, use APA 7 edition to write your references, okay, yeah. APA 7 edition for your references, okay? So there are a lot of homework for you to do before submitting your final dissertation. Okay, right. Okay. Thank you. Terima kasih, Prof. Agus Nuryatin.
Baik, terima kasih, Prof. Yan. Penguji berikutnya, Profesor Dr. Isi Yulia Sri, MPD, dipersilakan, Prof. Waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Terima kasih kesempatannya. Ibu Asih, congratulations for the completion of your dissertation up to this point. And I will ask you some questions for you to defend. Now, first of all, I will ask you what finding is the most significant contribution to the teaching of reading and writing among the findings of your research? Which is the most significant for the betterment of the teaching of reading and writing?
Well, okay, I think, yes, I said before that I have 9 findings. Yeah, I have checked it in my finding, chapter 4. I have 9 findings. It's about the interpersonal and additional and textual meaning of utterances and gestures. If I was asked to choose which one is most significant, is most beneficial, I think, almost all of them are beneficial, Provisi, but actually, in this case, maybe I'm not sure about my answer, because I think that 9 of them are very important for the teaching and learning process, but if I have to answer is that about the utterances. Utterances here, I think, are very important in the teaching and learning process, because without utterances given by the lecturer, it will make the student maybe a little bit frustrated or something, because lecturer's utterances are given to give some explanations or given some information to the student about the material being discussed in the classroom.
Okay, so particularly in the teaching of reading and writing, perhaps utterances are more dominant when dealing with the teaching, terms of a mode, yeah. What about the teaching of speaking? I think, do you agree with me, in the case of teaching speaking or in speaking class, do you think that gestures would be more significant in the teaching of speaking than it is in the teaching of reading and writing? What do you think?
In the teaching reading and teaching speaking, I think it's different. In speaking, I think it should be like a student-centered. So the most who are active are the students, not the lecturers. That's why, in my opinion, in teaching speaking, I think the lecturer should not talk a lot. The one that should talk a lot should be the student, not the lecturers. That's why here, I think utterances is maybe less than the one when the lecturer teach reading in speaking.
Okay. Do you mean to say that in reading and writing, you don't need to use the student-centered learning?
Of course, both of them use student-centered learning.
Okay.
Yeah, but in this case, the lecturer as the mediator. Yeah, I think in the teaching.
Okay. So. I've been a teacher for over 30 years now, and I've never realized that gestures somehow contribute to students' better understanding of the teacher's speech. as you analyze in your study. I use them a lot, yeah, because I'm a kind of extroverted personality. You know, I use a lot of gesture when I speak. You know, but I just took it for granted. And so, with these research findings, will you suggest that teachers use gestures more when they teach in the future because somehow it has communicative meaning? What do you think? Would you suggest that?
Yeah, the teachers should use gesture, but I think that should be appropriate with the classroom to is not more gesture. So I think it is not
too much gesture.
Yeah, too overacting like this one. Yeah. I know that like Bu Isi, I think also use more gesture when you are speaking, but I think not so much. Yeah, not so many, but I think appropriate. It's appropriate or balance with the one that you talk.
Okay.
Balance.
Okay. Now when I think I would assume that a person with extroverted personality would use more gestures than a person who is introverted, right?
Yes,
so
yes.
What is your suggestion to the introverted teachers in terms of using gestures?
Yes, I think the lecturer or the teacher here should use gesture, because if the lecturer or teacher without using gesture, in my experience when I was studying in my S1, that the student maybe will talk themselves. But if the teachers or lecturer use gesture, I think they will pay attention to the gesture performed by the lecturers. That's why I hope that the teacher in teaching should use gesture. Yeah, okay. And I think it will contribute to the classroom.
All right. Okay, next. So what is your suggestion for the next researcher? Would you, because you didn't compare, like in this study, you haven't compared like the use of gestures in combination with utterances in compared to the teaching of speaking, for example. You just explore the use of the combinations of utterances and gestures in the teaching of reading and writing. So what is your suggestion for the teaching of other skills of language?
For the researcher, you mean?
For the next researcher, what would you suggest?
Yes, for the next researcher, I think it is a kind of a good idea to analyze not only the gesture, but I think there are several modes in the classroom. Yeah, should be like a spoken language and then written language, gesture, even movement. Movement can also be analyzed using SFMDA, but of course it needs some kind of lab, yeah, some kind of laboratory, because every movement is counted, every place, and also the number of the distance is also counted. And I think it is not, in my campus, there is no sufficient tools to analyze the movement. But maybe next time, the lecturer or the next researcher can compare. The one that is completed is in Singapore, University of National of Singapore. I think there is lab of multimodal laboratory. And also it is analyzed by Victor Lim. Yeah, Lim, I think, is also one of my framework that, yeah, I think he is an expert in SFMDA, not only about utterance and gesture, but every mode in a certain communication.
All right. Now, Bu Asi, what will your future teaching of reading and writing be like after you have done this research? Will there be any impact of this study on the way you teach reading and writing?
Yes, of course. By analyzing utterance and gesture here, I realized that they are very important. That's why I will give, for me and also for the other lecturers who teach reading, I think who teach reading not only me, but can be the other lecturers, right? So I give a kind of suggestion that the kind of mode are very important. And so that to make the classroom maybe a live classroom, not just a silent classroom without any utterances given or gesture performed by the lecturers.
So what will you suggest specifically to your colleagues at Udinus and to your colleagues of English, you know, department of other universities.
Yes, I will suggest. Yeah, I will suggest to my colleagues in Udinus that this kind of mode, of course, is very important in the teaching and learning process. That's why they should use not only one mode in the classroom. Yeah, maybe not only spoken, but also yeah, movement and gesture and so on. And of course, it will be the contribution to them to improve maybe the teaching and learning process in the future.
All right. Thank you very much, Ibu Asih. Congratulations.
Thank you, Prof. Isi.
Baik, terima kasih Bu Prof. Isi. Menguji berikutnya, Profesor Dr. Marsono, dipersilakan Prof. Marsono, waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Terima kasih, Bapak Ketua. Oke, congratulations, Bu Mulatsi.
Thank you.
I think I'll not spend the 10 minutes. Some of the questions I was going to raise have been raised by Prof. Yan, for example, about the significances of the study. You have 9 research questions. In fact, you should have 9 significances. Each research question is usually described, I mean, each research question should have its own significance and viewed from 3 points of view, from the practical point of view, from the pedagogical point of view, from the theoretical point of view.
Yes.
But again, as Yan already mentioned, you have only 6, I think, 6 years university study, or 7. Yeah, 7.
7.
Out of 9. Then about the review of the previous study, I think I also mentioned to you before, even before your previous examination or the close examination, I mentioned to you that the review of previous study should contain the review of at least of 100 articles. But you still, until the end, until the open examination, you still review, in fact, in the last one, in this journey, you only review 6 instead of 100. Yeah. Okay, so those questions have been raised by Yan. Now, I still have about 2 more questions, so it'll be less than 10 minutes. Yeah, so you are analyzing the modes of teaching. There are a lot of modes you mentioned, but you focus on 2 different modes, the utterances and the gestures. About the utterances, you deal with the three strands of meaning in language. Analyze the interpersonal meaning, the ideational meaning, the textual meaning. Yeah. then you have the text, the analysis of the gestures. Now, if you look at your research question, question number 1, number 2, focus on the ideational meaning, right?
Yes.
Ideational meaning, yeah, about processes, about participants, about circumstances.
Number 1 and 2.
Yeah, number 1 and number 2, right. Yeah. Number 1 and 2 are about ideational meaning. Then research question number 4 particularly, and also perhaps number 3 and number 5 could be grouped into the analysis of interpersonal meaning, right? Interpersonal meaning. Now, my question is, which question raises the question about textual meaning in the utterances point of view?
Well, this is question number 1 and number 2 refers to additional meaning. And then this is question number 3 and number 4 refers to interpersonal meaning.
Yeah.
This is question number 5 that belongs to textual meaning.
Number 5.
Number 5 and number 9.
Number nine is not about utterances. No, that is about gestures.
About utterances, number five, textual meaning.
Yeah. Or number five is about textual meaning.
About the theme, yeah.
It's the question of what is the question about? Can you say it again? Question number five is about?
What type of theme are dominantly used by the lecturers in teaching, reading,
and writing? Oh, theme is about textual, is it?
Yeah, theme is textual meaning, sir.
Okay. Yeah, right. You, it means you have asked all the questions about the utterances, interpersonal meaning, additional meaning, and textual meaning. Yeah. right. Yeah, no further question about that then. Now, you stated in your oral presentation also, you mentioned that each mode contributes meaning. In other words, you were saying that each mode will have some positive effect in the reception of the teaching material by the students. Now, did you actually see or did you actually measure this effect on the reception of the each mode, of reception of the material as the effect of the mode by students? Did you measure that, or did you see that, or is it only on your assumption?
I didn't analyze about the effects on the student, no. But it is it's only a systemic functional multimodal analysis. It's a classroom discourse analysis. So I didn't analyze the effect. Maybe if I analyze the effect, I will give a kind of questionnaire. No, I didn't give the questionnaire to students about the effect of the mode used by the lecturers.
Yeah, but you made a statement. It has some meaning. It means that you must also show that it actually has some effect on the students, and the reception of the material by the students. If you do not show the actual effect, then the reader will feel that you are making only an assumption, not real effect as a result of research. Yeah. So I think Wu has already mentioned some that statements should be based on facts. Yeah, on the result of the research. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, that's my last question I want to raise to you. Yeah. So anyway, congratulations, Butlachi. I think I believe you still need to make some improvement in your dissertation. But you mentioned there are also some grammatical mistakes that you still have to revise. Yeah. Okay. I think that's all, Bu Mulachi. Thank you for answering my questions.
Yeah. Thank you. Pak
Ketua, saya akhiri pertanyaan saya. Waktu saya kembalikan kepada Bapak Ketua. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih, Prof. Harsono. Penguji terakhir, Prof. Mursyid Saleh. Dipersilakan, Prof. Mursyid, waktu maksimal 10 menit.
Iya. Oh, gaptek ini. Bu Sri Mulatse.
Yes, Prof.
Let me join the other examiners in congratulating you for your success in completing your dissertation. I have no serious objection with your dissertation unless I accept two things. I have two concerns. Hello, are you there?
Yes, Prof.
The first one is about the research questions. It had been asked by Puli and also Rovian about your research questions. You have 9 research questions. All of them are what? But of course, research questions are asked in order to find the information in accordance with the question word that you use. The question word will gain only a type of information which is descriptive or identification. So when you ask what, the answer will be identifying something. And identifying is the lowest competence in Bloom taxonomy. You know that? So you should have asked more higher levels of Bloom's taxonomy, not just identification, but also application, analysis, and synthesis, and interpretation. In order to find interpretive information, you can't ask only what question. You must ask how questions and also why questions, like what Pak just suggested. If you ask only what questions, then your dissertation will go lower than your dissertation to the level of a scripsy. So you should attempt to also answer how questions and also why question. Please do that. Well, of course, inside you may have good answers to how questions and also why questions.
Yes.
Only that you haven't identified them as how and why questions, how and why information. So please do that. Okay. And you know that you work with only one variable in your research, and that variable is multimodality, consisting of two levels, utterances and gestures. So one variable with two levels, utterances and gestures. Each mode is divided into three levels, ideational,
interpersonal,
and textual. So you should have, from this alone, you should have already 6 questions, 2 × 3. 2 × 3 pertanyaannya. Gesture, utterance, masing-masing ada ideational, interpersonal, and textual. Jadi mestinya ada 6 pertanyaan what. 6 pertanyaan what. Belum lagi the setting. Settingnya the teaching of writing and the teaching of reading. Jadi mestinya ada 2 × 3 × 2 pertanyaan. What questions, ya kan? 12 questions, 12 what questions. And you only ask how many? 9 what questions. So where are the 3 missing questions?
Can I explain, Prof?
Yes, please.
Yeah, okay. Well, why I have 9 research questions? Because for interpersonal meaning, for additional meaning, there are 2 questions that refer to additional meaning, number 1 and number 2. And then for interpersonal meaning, I have 2 research questions, number 3 and number 4. And then number 5 is about textual meaning. And then number 6 about the type of gestures used by the lecturers. Types here can be performative or communicative gestures. And then for the 3 last research question here about interpersonal, additional, and textual meanings of gesture. That's why there are 9 questions. And then why there are only 9 questions? Because in every question, I don't separate reading and writing one by one, but I want to show about here the differences between the additional meaning or processes participant in the teaching, reading and writing, not reading itself and writing, but reading and writing. So that's why there are 9. There are 9 research questions, not 9 times to become 18, no, right? And also inside the why what, because inside the what actually they are how and why, as what you have just mentioned, that in my finding actually they are why and how. But in this question, maybe I will revise into what and how and why, yeah, in one research question. So that
in other words you are questioning, you are asking one question for 2 answers, is that right?
No, two interpersonal meaning for 2 research questions.
Yeah, 2 answers.
Yeah.
1 question requiring 2 answers.
Yeah.
No, you can't do that. Research questions must be specific. So 1 question, 1 answer. You can't ask 1 question for 2 answers.
No, interpersonal meaning for two and two research question, and the answer also only also
no,
two.
No. You can ask. You can ask for two information, two types of information, with only one question.
No.
Siapa nama gurumu dan temanmu? Satu pertanyaan untuk dua informasi tidak boleh. Jadi kalau ada dua informasi yang Anda tanyakan, siapa nama temanmu, siapa nama gurumu. Okay? Your question must be specific. One question for one answer.
Because the finding about teaching and writing, I put it in one table, sir. In one table.
Look at research methodology. Bagaimana merumuskan pertanyaan, ya? Okay, you can ask, you can formulate one question for two answers, for two types of information. Dua jenis informasi tidak bisa ditanyakan dengan satu pertanyaan. Okay? Lihat research methodology. Okay? So please formulate 12 questions, 12 word questions. Dan itu tidak cukup karena harus ada pertanyaan how and why as Prof. Yan suggested. Jadi mestinya pertanyaan Anda tidak hanya 9, bisa 12, bisa 15. Okay?
Yes.
Now, my second concern is about your methodology, especially in technique of data analysis. Dalam teknik data analysis, Anda menyebut ada apa ya? Come on. You are doing qualitative research, so the procedure of data analysis should consist of selection, categorization, comparison, synthesis, and interpretation.
On page 93.
No, look at your table of contents, page 12. 3.6, technique of data analysis. There you have organizing and preparing the data, and then segmenting, encoding, and then identifying, tabulating, and then interpreting. Identifying should come first. Jadi itu ada logical disorder itu ya. Logically, you should identify the data first before you can organize them, before you can segment them, before you can code them. You should identify your data first. So 3.6.3 should come first, and then 3.6.2 second, and then 3.6.1 third. Kebalik ya, 3.6.1, 3.6.2, 3.6.3. Mestinya 3.6.3 dulu, 3.6.2, 3.6.1. That is the logical order. Jadi sebelum data diklasifikasi, diidentify dulu. Jangan diklasifikasi dulu baru diidentify. Okay? And please also make it consistent inside. Jadi di topiknya seperti itu, di dalamnya juga seperti itu. Okay, I'm sorry, the time is up. Thank you very much, Pak Direktur. Congratulations, Bu Mulase.
Thank you, Prof.
Baik. Dengan demikian pertanyaan dan sanggahan penguji ujian promosi doktor selesai.
Ketua penguji menunda ujian untuk memberikan waktu kepada para penguji melaksanakan rapat yudisium.
Untuk memberikan waktu kepada tim penguji dalam menentukan hasil ujian, dengan ini ujian promosi doktor atas nama Saudari DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD dinyatakan ditunda.
Rapat yudisium dipimpin oleh Ketua Penguji. Ujian promosi doktor pendidikan dilanjutkan kembali. Ketua penguji membuka kembali ujian promosi doktor pendidikan.
Ujian promosi doktor pendidikan atas nama Saudari DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD dinyatakan dibuka kembali. Berikut saya bacakan berita acara ujian disertasi tahap 2. Pada hari ini, Kamis tanggal 18 bulan Februari tahun 2021, di Pascasarjana Universitas Negeri Semarang, UNES, telah diselenggarakan ujian disertasi tahap 2 atas nama DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD pada program studi Ilmu Pendidikan Bahasa Pascasarjana UNES dengan disertasi yang berjudul Systemic Functional Multimodal Discourse Analysis of the Lecturer's Utterances and Gestures Used in Teaching, Reading, and Writing. Setelah dilaksanakan ujian dan dilaksanakan rapat penguji, keputusan tim penguji menyatakan bahwa DRA Sri Mulatsih MPD dinyatakan lulus sebagai doktor pendidikan. Dr. Sri Mulatsih MPD adalah doktor ke-578 lulusan UNES atau doktor ke-118 lulusan Prodi Ilmu Pendidikan Bahasa Pascasarjana UNES dengan masa studi 7 tahun 5 bulan. Karya ilmiah disertasi diberi penghargaan dengan nilai A sehingga IPK menjadi 3,97. Hasil akhir ujian promosi doktor pendidikan dengan predikat kelulusan sangat memuaskan. Nama ketua penguji, sekretaris Profesor Dr. Agus Nuryadin Embum. Pembacaan selesai.
Ketua penguji mempersilahkan promotor untuk menyampaikan kesan dan pesan.
Saudara promotor dipersilakan menyampaikan kesan dan pesan. Suara Prof belum muncul. Silakan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih atas kesempatan untuk memberikan kesan dan pesan. Saya tujukan kepada Dr. Sri Mulatsih. Saya merasa mendapat kehormatan untuk menyebut nama Anda dengan gelar doktor untuk yang kedua setelah yang pertama disebutkan oleh Bapak Direktur. Jadi, Saudara Dr. Sri Mulatsih, perkenankanlah saya terlebih dulu sebelum memberikan pesan dan kesan, menyampaikan selamat atas keberhasilan Anda mencapai gelar doktor yang keberapa tadi, mungkin nomornya sudah banyak sekali. Nah, mudah-mudahan keberhasilan Anda ini tidak bermanfaat hanya untuk Anda pribadi, tapi juga untuk keluarga, masyarakat, lembaga, bangsa, dan negara. Amin. Ya Rabbal Alamin. Selanjutnya, sebelum saya memberikan pesan dan kesan, perkenankanlah juga saya minta maaf kepada Ibu Sri Mulatsih. Kenapa? Karena terutama kesan saya pada awalnya, saya punya kesan yang kurang mulia terhadap Bu Sri Mulasih. Maaf ini, mungkin terkait dengan lamanya waktu studi karena berbagai hal. Tapi percayalah bahwa ternyata saya salah sangka. Jadi sesudah tahun terakhir, beberapa bulan terakhir, Ibu Sri Mulasih menghubungi saya lagi sesudah sekian lama tenggelam, memberikan alasan mengapa tertunda kelulusannya itu. Dan alasan itu sangat dapat saya terima. Justru saya sangat menghargai Ibu Sri Mulasih sebagai calon doktor yang mempunyai sifat-sifat yang sangat mulia. Sifat-sifat yang kurang mulia yang hampir saja saya lemparkan ke Bu Sri Mulasih adalah kurang bersungguh-sungguh, malas, bahkan tidak mampu. Maaf, itu awal-awal dulu. Tapi ternyata sesudah mendengar cerita Bu Sri Mulasih, ketiga label itu semuanya salah. Jadi Ibu seorang yang sangat bersungguh-sungguh di dalam menempuh studi ini, tidak keset, karena ternyata tulisannya terus mengalir, jadi proses berjalan terus, meskipun lama tidak ketemu saya. Kemudian bahwa Bu Sri Mulasih tidak mampu juga sudah terbantahkan dengan keberhasilan Bu Sri Mulasih menyelesaikan studinya ini. Yang menjadi kendala sebetulnya adalah justru karena hal-hal yang di luar kemampuan Bu Sri Mulasih untuk mengatasi, dan ini justru menjadi nilai lebih bagi saya, bagi seorang ibu berhasil mengatasi masalah-masalah sehingga berhasil dalam studi. Bagi saya ini satu poin tersendiri. Saya lebih menghargai seorang ibu yang berhasil menempuh studi sampai gelar doktor daripada seorang bapak yang berhasil menempuh doktor. Jadi ternyata keterlambatan ini karena hal-hal yang menjadi tanggung jawab Bu Sri Mulasih yang justru menjadikannya sangat terpuji, yaitu mendahulukan putra-putranya sehingga lebih menerima kelulusannya sendiri tertunda sesudah putranya lulus universitas dan mendapatkan pekerjaan. Yang kedua, merawat suami yang sakit. Alhamdulillah semuanya itu sudah teratasi dan insya Allah hari ini merupakan janji Allah bahwa orang yang sabar akan mendapatkan pahala yang tak terbatas. Keberhasilan Bu Sri Mulasih merupakan pemenuhan janji Allah untuk orang-orang yang sabar. Jadi Bu Sri Mulasih termasuk orang yang sabar, orang yang ikhlas, semoga ini mendapat balasan yang berlimpah dari Allah SWT. Kemudian yang menjadi pesan saya, Bu Sri Mulasih, ya, ini bukan akhir perjalanan akademik Anda, jadi masih menunggu tugas-tugas berikutnya yang banyak sekali. Oleh karenanya, anggaplah ini suatu awal dari perjalanan baru yang kedepannya Ibu dituntut untuk lebih banyak berkarya. Dan semoga Allah memberkati Anda, mendapatkan kesuksesan-kesuksesan berikutnya, sehingga Anda akan menjadi orang yang bermanfaat, tidak hanya bagi sendiri, tapi bagi diri sendiri, tapi juga bagi keluarga, masyarakat, bangsa, dan negara. Jadi ucapan saya, sesudah Anda menyelesaikan S3, ucapan saya S banyak sekali. Selamat, semoga sukses selalu, sehat, sejahtera, dan sebagainya. Dan selanjutnya, Allah meridhoi. Amin ya rabbal alamin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ujian promosi doktor pendidikan atas nama Dr. Sri Mulasih, MPD ditutup oleh Ketua Penguji.
Baik. Belum ujian ini saya tutup, saya menyampaikan dulu ucapan selamat kepada Dr. Sri Mulatsi M.Pd. Sekarang ini secara resmi saudari sudah meraih gelar akademis tertinggi sebagai doktor. Mudah-mudahan gelar doktor ini makin menambah, meningkatkan kualitas intelektual dan kepribadian negari. Dan mudah-mudahan mendatangkan berkah bagi saudari, keluarga, lembaga tempat saudari bekerja, dan masyarakat pada umumnya. Ucapan selamat ini juga saya sampaikan kepada keluarga Ibu Sri Mulatsi, suami atau kepada anak-anak juga, mudah-mudahan juga membahagiakan. Kalau tadi disebut Ibu sudah mendahulukan kelulusan dari kuliah, ini menunjukkan kepada putra-putri Ibu bahwa Ibu ini seorang Ibu yang luar biasa, yang bisa meraih gelar doktor di tengah kesibukan dari dalam pekerjaan dan juga di rumah. Kemudian mengucapkan selamat juga dan terima kasih kepada tempat Ibu Dr. Sri Mulatsi ini bekerja, itu untuk keluarga besar Universitas Dian Nuswantoro Semarang. Khususnya ini kami ucapkan selamat dan terima kasih pada Rektor Udinus, Bapak Profesor Dr. Insinyur Edi Nursasongko M.Kom. Kedua, kepada Ketua Yayasan Dian Nuswantoro Semarang, Ibu Haja Tri Rustanti S.E.M.M. Yang ketiga, ucapan selamat dan terima kasih pada Wakil Rektor 1 Udinus, Profesor Dr. Supriyadi Rustad M.Si. Kemudian pada Wakil Rektor 2 Udinus, Profesor Dr. ST Wiyarso Utomo S.E.M.Kom. ACA. Lalu kepada Wakil Rektor 3 Udinus, Dr. Gusni Ingsih M.M. Kemudian kepada Wakil Rektor 4 Udinus, Dr. Pulung Nurtantio Andono STM.Kom. Juga kepada Dekan Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Udinus, yang Dr. Raden Arif Nugroho M.Bum, kasih Pak Dekan. Lalu kepada Ketua Prodi Bahasa Inggris Udinus, Dr. Sunardi S.S. M.Pd. Dan ucapan selamat dan terima kasih. Berikutnya, Alhamdulillahirrahmanirrahim, dan dengan seizin Bapak Ibu serta hadirin sekalian, ujian promosi doktor pendidikan atas nama Dr. Sri Mulatsi M.Pd. secara resmi saya nyatakan ditutup. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Matur nuwun,
Profesor. Upacara selesai dilanjutkan dengan pemberian ucapan selamat. Ucapan selamat diawali dari Ketua Penguji.
Baik, atas nama Ketua Penguji, Dr. Rohmat, saya ucapkan selamat sekali lagi kepada Dr. Sri Mulaci. Mudah-mudahan makin berkah. Terima kasih.
Dilanjutkan oleh Profesor Dr. Suwandi MPD.
Terima kasih. Selamat pada Ibu Dr. Sri Mulaseh atas capek ya. Oke. Selamat Ibu Dr. Sri Mulaseh atas capaiannya dalam meraih level pendidikan tertinggi doktor. But remember that gelar doktor bukanlah segala-galanya. Jangan tinggi hati dengan gelar ini, tapi merunduklah seperti padi yang mentes, bukan seperti padi yang gagal panen. Ya, semoga berkah untuk Bu Mulaceh ya, menjadi membuat kebahagiaan bagi keluarga. Terima kasih.
Dilanjutkan oleh Ibu Sri Wuli Fitriati, SPD MPD PXD.
Masih mute.
Izin suaranya Ibu.
Masih mute, Bu Uli.
Masih mute. Rusak. Ya. Di unmute. Oh, enggak bisa ya.
Ada masalah, Pak. Enggak apa-apa.
Ya.
Dilanjutkan oleh Profesor Dr. Januarius Mujianto,
MPD. Ya, untuk Bu Sri Mulaceh ya, selamat ya. Ini bukan akhirnya tapi awalnya ya. Awal dari pengabdian yang lebih mantap ya di UDINUS. Sebab itu selamat, congratulations, dan juga selamat untuk teman-teman di UDINUS yang bersama-sama mengabdi untuk bangsa dan negara. Terima kasih.
Sudah bisa saya. Bu Ace, Ibu Dr. Sri Mulaceh. Selamat ya Bu, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Saya ya ikut berbahagia. Mudah-mudahan disertasinya bisa menjadi monograf ya Bu untuk dipublikasikan untuk banyak orang. Ya, selamat ya Bu, alhamdulillah. Ya. Makasih Mbak Ani.
Sama-sama Ibu, dilanjutkan oleh Profesor Dr. Isi Yuliasri MPD.
Bu Asih, mengucapkan selamat kepada Bu Asih dan selamat buat keluarga yang selama ini telah mendukung. Semoga membawa maslahat bagi banyak orang dan lebih produktif.
Dilanjutkan oleh Profesor Dr. Warsono, Dipdel MA.
Terima kasih. Selamat Bu Mulaci ya. Selamat Bu Mulaci untuk keluarga Bu Mulaci. Untuk UDINUS, mudah-mudahan dengan tambahnya satu dokter UDINUS ini, UDINUS akan semakin maju ke depan, makin moncer gitu ya. Ya, saya kira itu ucapan dari saya. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Dilanjutkan oleh Profesor Mursyid Saleh, MAPXD.
Iya, ucapan selamat saya sudah saya sampaikan ya, Mbak Ace. Selamat sekali lagi dan ikut bersyukur atas keberhasilan Anda. Semoga disusul dengan keberhasilan-keberhasilan lebih lanjut. Jangan lupa bersyukur dan mohon pada Allah. Jadi masih banyak tugas yang menunggu supaya Anda bisa membagi waktu dan insya Allah diberi kesehatan, kesejahteraan, kemuliaan. Amin. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum. Maaf juga kalau ada kesalahan selama ini ya. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Dipersilakan untuk Bapak Ibu tamu undangan untuk memberikan ucapan selamat.
Selamat kepada Bu Mulace. Semoga menjadi ilmu yang bermanfaat dan berkah.
Matur suwun, Prof. Matur suwun.
Satu tahap lagi menjadi profesor. Jangan berhenti.
Terima kasih, amin.
Selamat, yeah. Salam buat keluarga.
Iya, yeah, amin, Prof.
Monggo, Bu Kusni.
Selamat untuk Bu Sri Mulatsi. Sukses, semoga bisa berkontribusi untuk pengembangan Universitas Dian Santoro.
Amin.
Selamat.
Selamat, Bu Asih.
Terus, Pak Arif.
Selamat, Bu Asih. Atas gelar dokternya, semoga bermanfaat bagi masyarakat.
Matur nuwun, Mbak Narji.
Matur nuwun juga untuk seluruh tim penguji, tim Pasca UNES, sudah menguji Bu Asih, matur nuwun. Matur nuwun juga rawuhipun Prof. Edi, Bu Kusni, matur nuwun.
Matur nuwun.